Hello, and welcome to Prairie Pulse. Coming up a little bit later in the show, we'll profile Middle River, Minnesota Community Theater. But first, joining me now is Paul Lucy, the director of the North Dakota Economic Development and Finance Division. Paul, thanks for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thank you, John.
As we get started, Paul, tell the folks a little bit about yourself and your background, where you're originally from.
Well, I am a North Dakota native. Grew up in northwestern North Dakota on a farm ranch up by Powers Lake, North Dakota. Coming out of high school, I got caught up in the oil boom of the late 70s, early 80s, and spent about 7 years off and on doing that across the country in various employment areas. Eventually, I went back to college and got a business degree. And when I graduated, I ended up in an internship with a small business development center. That led me into working for a regional planning council up in the Minot area, which gave me great exposure to the rural communities up in that region and the various state programs and national programs that are available to support business development. From there, I went out to western North Dakota and worked in McKenzie County for the Jobs Development Authority and the Tourism Bureau, again doing economic development. Eventually went back to Minot for 10 years with the Minot Area Development Corporation, and then went out to Fargo for 2 years and worked for the Fargo-Moorhead Economic Development Corporation. And those years of experience working for rural communities, working in rural areas, working in the largest community in the state with the large research university, and having the exposure that I did, when the position came available with economic development and finance, I guess I appeared to be somewhat of the right fit. And so I've been there now for about 5 years, since October of 2006.
Okay, well, yeah, it sounds like you worked right up to that job. But so tell the folks out there a little bit about what does the Economic Development and Finance Division do?
Okay, so I'm going to simplify this first to start with, and we call it EDNF. Makes it easy for people to say. So EDNF, first the Department of Commerce, EDNF is a division within the Department of Commerce. And the purpose of the Department of Commerce is really to attract, retain, and expand wealth in North Dakota. And so that's really our primary focus. Now, the EDNF division, our efforts are targeted towards what we call primary sector businesses. Now, yes, we do spend some time working with retail service businesses as well, but primary sector is where we put our greatest focus. And that business can look at us as a liaison between them, the private sector, and state government. If they have any issues, challenges, opportunities that they're facing with their business, whether they're a startup, whether they're an expansion, whether they're a new company looking to move into the state, we're really that resource that they can turn to work on site identification for them in North Dakota, financial packaging, and a variety of other different things. We also do a fair bit of marketing of the state around the country and around the world to let companies know about the attributes of the state, the infrastructure that we have, the people, the work ethic that we have, to try and attract more companies to the state. We work a great deal with our existing companies in North Dakota, really in a variety of different ways to help them as they're expanding and growing and to access the resources in the state. But secondly, there's great opportunity for cross-selling amongst existing manufacturers in particular. And so we will introduce companies to each other that maybe we see that there's a fit, that one company could be hiring another local in-state company to do manufacturing for them rather than being sourced or supplied by a company from out of state. And then, of course, economic development really happens at the local level. And so we turn to our local partners and we provide assistance to our local partners, whether it's community leaders or economic development organizations at the local level. And we provide assistance, whether it's strategic planning, whether it's supporting their initiatives to attract business, whether it's to supporting their efforts to put financing packages together, or even accessing the various agencies within the state. And so we could spend hours talking about all the different things we do, but basically we're that liaison between the private sector and the public sector as they're looking to grow.
Yeah, and you mentioned working with existing companies and then marketing, you said internationally, I believe you mentioned also. But so does your job require a lot of travel to find those companies, or are the companies mainly coming to you, or is it just a mixture of both?
It's a combination of both. Yeah. Both. We travel some. We have a staff that has leveled areas of expertise. Mm-hmm. And so we target certain industries, and we use our specific staff to travel many times to certain markets and have conversations with companies, whether it's companies that have indicated an interest in North Dakota or whether we have had an outreach program and set up appointments and went and had conversations with them. But again, our primary focus is working with those in-state businesses and helping them grow and expand, and then also looking to attract those other companies. So there is a fair bit of travel.
Sure. Well, then can you comment some, what do you think the key's been to North Dakota's success, economically, when the rest of the nation seems to struggle?
Sure. Well, I guess I'd say one word, diversification. You know, if you go back 20 years to the early Vision 2000 process and the beginning of the growing North Dakota programs, North Dakota at that time really began to diversify. And yes, we are heavily dependent on agriculture and energy, but at the same time, we've begun to realize that we need more manufacturing, we need more technology-based businesses, we need more information technology-based businesses, more effort in terms of expanding our tourism exposure around the country, around the world. And so I'd say diversification is what's really helped us. Then secondly, you know, we have fiscally responsible government here in the state. And so we put together a system in North Dakota that allows companies to operate without real government interference. And that makes us attractive to people as well.
Okay. Well, let's talk about the oil boom, because obviously that's had some impact.
Sure.
It's had a lot of impact on the state. How many oil rigs right now are operating in North Dakota, and how many companies, I guess, are involved with that?
You know, the last count I saw was 200 active rigs drilling. Now, if you compare that back to the last big oil boom that we had going on in the late 70s, early 80s, I think it was somewhere around 150 rigs. And so with 200 rigs drilling, and they're probably a little more concentrated now than they were back last time. Recent numbers I heard are there are somewhere around 510 direct oil industry related companies operating in the state. Now, those were numbers from 2010. So obviously since over the last year, we've seen an increase in those number of companies.
Okay. Well, can you talk about some of the workers who are coming to North Dakota? I mean, it sounds like, you know, and of course, a lot of times I jokingly tell people, yeah, if you need a job, come to North Dakota. But it sounds like they're coming from everywhere. Is that right?
Yes. You know, Job Service put out some numbers again recently, and there's over 18,000 available job postings in the state. Now, a lot of people assume that those job postings are strictly in western North Dakota, but in actuality, a majority of those are in the eastern part of the state, and they're really all across the state. And so it's funny that where the people are coming from and how many are coming. I live in Minot on weekends. That's where my home is. And I had a neighbor move in across the street. And of course, I went over and introduced myself. Well, he's from Idaho. And he wasn't here just for the oil industry. He came up to be the manager for Alamo. And so we're seeing people from all over the country showing up. I had some clients in my office just recently that were going to go on a day and a half trip out in the western side of the United States, of North Dakota, to pursue opportunities, find out what opportunities there were. It's just kind of a poke around trip for them. They came back and they spent some time visiting with me, and they said in that day and a half, they saw 23 license plates from different states. And so we're seeing people coming from all over, but It's all over the state. It's not just into western North Dakota. It's into eastern North Dakota and central North Dakota where there's opportunities every place.
Hmm. Well, can you talk some about the business climate, which we've been doing here in North Dakota? Because I've heard officials talk about being sort of friendly to businesses and North Dakota strives to be welcoming to businesses. I mean, what does that mean? I mean, obviously any state would say that, wouldn't they?
I think first and foremost, you have to have an environment that businesses can be successful in. And if I was to say what is the top thing in our environment, I would say that, again, going back to our fiscally responsible government, that attempts to control taxes, does a very good job of it. Over the last 6 years, we've seen decrease in taxes while the rest of the country, most of the state, have needed to impose increases. And so first and foremost, we've got a good tax climate. And that gives companies some sense of stability too, and security that they're going to be able to remain competitive in the marketplace because they aren't going to see their taxes increase. Secondly, responsiveness. If someone contacts our office or any other agency within state government, they're going to get a response, and they're going to be treated as if they're just as important as the biggest business in the state. The smallest business will get treated just like they're the biggest business in the state. An example of that, we had a client come into the state recently, and we ended up in our meeting, we had the Department of Transportation, we had the Tax Department, we had the Water Commissioner, and we had the Bank of North Dakota, we had the Department of Commerce and our finance programs within the Department of Commerce, USDA, and a variety of others at the table. And the company made the comment that there's no way that we would ever see this if we went into another state. And we do that, and I say we, I'm talking all the state government, and not just government people, but people in general, associations, organizations, private business. We do that with sincerity. It's not just to put on a show. When we get done with the meeting, we're going to follow up and we're going to address either the opportunities that they're facing or the challenges they're facing. Either way, we're going to address them.
Hmm. Well, what kind of calls does your office get from out-of-state prospective businesses? And do you get it on a monthly, weekly, or daily basis? Yeah,
well, recently it's certainly been on a daily basis and many times daily. Majority of our calls that we're getting recently, as you might suspect, are focused around activity in the oil counties. And a lot of those are developers that are saying, how can I come to North Dakota and assist in, say, an issue like the housing? And so we will provide them information as much as we can. With people like that, it's best that we tell them to, you know, get out here, get some boots on the ground, see what's happening, have conversations with people at the local level. But the calls we're really receiving beyond just the oil activity calls are businesses in general that are looking to expand, and they may be in another state and they're asking us for information because they're considering North Dakota as they're considering other states as well. It might be a startup entrepreneur that is unsure where to turn, where to begin, and so it really covers the gamut of the individuals and levels of other companies and individuals that are calling.
Okay. Well, let's talk some about the programs that your office administers. What is the North Dakota Development Fund?
Well, the Development Fund was created in 1991, and they really are a gap financing mechanism to support business financing and targeted at primary sector businesses. Now they're unique in that they can provide equity financing as well as debt financing, but also they are structured for the purpose of taking a little more risk than a traditional conventional financer may take, and also they're flexible on the terms that they may provide to the clients that they invest in, and so I think not I think, but since 1991, they have invested nearly, or just over $80 million in 475 or more businesses across the state. I mean, if a company like Phoenix International, you may have seen a recent announcement that they're doing a large expansion, $22 million expansion. They have approximately 900 employees. Well, in their formative years, the Development Fund provided financial assistance to them, and you could look through that list of 475 companies that they've been involved in, and there's a number of those companies that over the years they were in early on or have come in at some point as they got to a point where their growth had taken them to where they really needed more financing to get over the hump to that next level, and Development Fund is just a tremendous mechanism to do that.
Okay. Well, how about the Agricultural Products Utilization Commission?
Okay. Another unique program. That's the, I would say, probably the oldest program within commerce, at least definitely within ED&F, formed in 1979. So Ag Products Utilization Commission, short, we call it APUC, for makes it easy for people. APUC is really about investing in business ideas that are going to provide or find new and expanded uses of agricultural products for the purpose of creating new businesses, new jobs, new wealth in the state. And so the unique thing about them is typically companies that are coming to APUC, the things that they need financial assistance with are not, they're really the intangible types of costs that you will not find, the traditional lender providing financing for business plans, feasibility studies, marketing plans, those types of things. Dakota Growers Pasta. If you go back to the very, very early stages of Dakota Growers Pasta, when they were forming and doing some feasibility studies and things like that, APUC was there to assist. And now they're one of the largest pasta producers in the nation.
Well, with some of these things, how many staff do you have?
We have 17 staff within the Economic Development and Finance Division. We really have three primary areas. We have the business development group, we have our research group, and then we have those finance programs, the Development Fund and APUC. And so with 17 people, we cover a lot of ground and we do a lot of work and assist a lot of individuals and companies.
It sounds like, have you added any staff with all the growth that's been going on?
Or? We added one staff person back in 2007 as things were, the activity was increasing in the state, and as we were redefining some of the roles of some of the business development staff in particular, we added one person. Again, I talked about bringing more expertise in, so we have staff that has expertise in energy, we have staff that has expertise in agriculture, science and technology, information technology, and so the way we have formed our team, we're very efficient. We utilize our local partners again quite a bit, and we utilize our partner programs that we have within commerce. Manufacturing Extension Partnership, Small Business Development Centers, Centers for Technology and Business, Regional Councils, variety of different partner programs. We've just gotten better at delivering the services with the staff that we have.
Well, Paul, do you have a success story in business you can tell us about that maybe the viewers might not know about?
Well, there's a long list of success stories. You know, I'd probably pick a small one, Dakota Micro, based in Cayuga, North Dakota. A lot of people probably haven't heard of Dakota Micro, probably haven't heard of Cayuga, down in the southeastern part of the state. They manufacture, design, develop, and manufacture rugged camera equipment that goes on agricultural implements and equipment. Have become very successful.
Well, you know, a few years ago, out-migration was a big subject matter, and it seems like that's sort of leveled off now. But what are opportunities for young people, young college graduates, and young people in the state?
Well, it is certainly different from a number of years ago, and we didn't have to go too far back before where out-migration was still an issue we were dealing with. If you look all across the state, you'll find, again, 18,000 job postings with job service, over 18,000, in multiple disciplines, multiple industry sectors all across the state.
If people want more information, where's the best place for them to go?
They can call us, 701-328-5300, or our website. I will send you the commerce website, indycommerce.com. Or indiebusiness.com, either way.
Thanks so much for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Stay tuned for more. Middle River, Minnesota is a very, very small town. But through hard work and some grant money, they have refurbished the old depot into the Middle River Community Theater, where local citizens put on plays and performance in a cozy and intimate setting.
Thank you very much.
It's open seating?
Yep, open seating.
Right, it's Audrey, where's my shirt? What?
You said that? Where's Lenny?
Oh, he's coming. He's moving pretty slow. He's got whiplash. The seatbelt went right around his neck. Pulled him straight up. I left him dangling.
Oh!
We have a sellout every night, and people enjoy it, and they look forward to it.
I'll be right back.
Our community likes history, and that is another thing. We want to keep our theater as original as possible. That's why we've kept the big sliding door for the audience to come through. We have the dressing room is the original passenger area.
Oh, there is a lot of pride, yes. I think what it means for a lot of people is that we're not as small socially, if you want to say it that way, than the stigma might be for a town this size. I mean, the talent that we see here, quality of the productions, we'd put it up against anybody else, I think, on a bigger scale.
Any ringing in the ears?
Oh, God. Tell him no!
Theater has a seating capacity of 80, and it's a cozy 80. I mean, we're packed pretty tight in there, and typically it is a sold-out crowd, so over the course of six nights, we're looking at close to 500 people that attend each performance, each Goose Festival.
This building is not the original depot. The original depot was burnt by was struck by lightning in 1904, and this particular building was brought down from Plume, Canada, located over northwest here along the tracks. So then in 1989, we put up a foundation and got the ground ready and moved the theater over to its present location.
I don't know the truth. Charlie was mumbling the whole time.
In 1990, we had our first production for the Children's Theater, and we did Hansel and Gretel. We've had a lot of improvements that we've done with the building. We had some board members and volunteers that built a deck on. The community club gave us the barbershop, so that was moved over, and that, of course, is our concession stand now.
We have gotten more grants than this in the past, but this last one was, it was part of the Minnesota Legacy Arts Grant. It was for $9,000, believe it or not. Then we were able to utilize part of it for the children's production. The other part was for the renovations on the outside of the theater. The inside, it's been, over the years, a lot of stuff has been done. Obviously, that's been painted. We've had seats that were donated by a church. We've recently been able to get new carpet on our stage and paint and siding and insulation. Kind of a labor of love, I would guess you would say, and a lot of volunteer efforts that have been put into the inside.
I am so happy to welcome you to the 37th Annual Goose Festival in Middle River. Middle River, a small town with a big heart and big ideas. Now let's have some big time fun. Welcome.
Goose Fest, we're in our 37th year. Community celebration that kind of just celebrates fall, but it's grown to the point where people are coming from all over the country. I mean, we got people from Washington that religiously come here every year too. The town grows from maybe 350 on a good day to, I know we get over 3,000 people in here. It's supposed to signify the opener of goose hunting season. The Goose Festival play is usually an adult comedy type play that we put on during the Goose Fest. Typically, we like to keep it open to anybody willing to give it a try. We're always looking for new things like that. And as far as acting, that again is open to anybody in the whole community. They come from as far as Thief River, further north than that. We've got them from out in the Newfoundland area. But it's the local talent pool is incredible. And that lends itself to some pride that everybody in the community seems to share. There's people that will plan their weekends around our play. And we're very proud of that fact.
We have a board of 12 people, and it takes everybody's, you know, help, and everybody pitches in. It's teamwork, and it's a lot of times it's hard work, but you know, we volunteer, and that's why we're on the board, I guess, because we want to keep our theater here, and we're proud of it.
He had to go really badly, and he just started running up the stairs.
But this is a show to run.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse for this week, and as always, thanks for watching.
Funding for Minnesota Legacy programs are provided by a grant from the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008, and by the members of Prairie Public.